welcome to the show.
Hello, enter the show. Welcome. Hey, just a minute. What? Where's Stanley? Where's Stanley the statue?
Where is he? There he is.
Oh, that's not Stanley. Stanley hasn't got a blooming great hooter like that.
I put the disguise on him this week.
Well, who's he supposed to be? William the Conk?
Stanley is in the guise of a famous literary figure.
Oh, I know, Ollie Beak.
It's not Ollie Beak. And you shouldn't laugh at him. He's got a magnificent nose.
Yes.
Many famous men in history had extra-large noses, all fine, upright and admirable people.
True, I suppose. I knew a man who was clean-living, honest, trustworthy and a paragon of virtue. And he had one of the biggest hooters I've ever seen.
Oh, yeah. What was his name?
Goodness knows. Goodness knows! Boom! Boom! I beg your pardon.
Julius Caesar had a very big nose, and he was a great leader.
Was he?
And what about that famous soldier statesman with a big nose called Oliver Cromwell?
Oliver Cromwell? That's a funny name for a nose. Cough. But as William Shakespeare said, a nose by any other name would smell the same.
The Duke of Wellington had a very prominent nose.
Did he?
And what happened when he stood on the shores of England, gazing out over the English Channel?
His nose was so long he caught a cold in France.
No, he didn't. His men all said, "We will follow old nosey to victory."
Hence the expression, "Follow your nose."
And after the Battle of Waterloo, Basil, yes, it was suggested that the Duke of Wellington should be made Emperor of France.
Get away. Yeah. They couldn't get his nose on the step.
But this man was probably the most famous name of all, Cyrano de Bergerac.
Oh, yes.
Now, his was a household name.
Oh, I knew a chap with a household name. Fred Kitchen. Mm. You couldn't get more household than that, could you? I wonder if there's anyone else called, like Bertie Bucket or Charlie Gastove. They're good household names.
What about Basil Brush?
I suppose, what are you talking about? I say, Mr. Roy.
Yeah?
You've forgotten the most famous schnoz of all.
Who's that?
Ah. Sitting at my piano the other day. I probably think that's funny.
Hey, Basil, our producer's got a good nose in finding guest artists for the show, hasn't he?
Oh, yes.
Do you know who he's got for us this week?
Yes, of course I do.
It's the Osmonds.
Steve.
Will we have to wait much longer to see the doctor, Mr. Roy?
No,
we've been here over an hour, you know.
Shouldn't be long now, Basil. Where next?
Oh, that's good. Good idea to have magazines in the doctor's waiting room, isn't it?
Yeah, it passes the time, doesn't it? And you can keep in touch with current events.
Mm-hmm.
What are you reading?
It's an article about cricket.
Oh, yeah.
This young fella, Jack Hobbs, looks very promising. What are you reading?
Oh, it's about proper diets. Recommends lots of fruit, you know. An apple a day keeps the doctor away.
Someone told my cousin Cyril that once.
Yeah?
He ate so many apples one morning they had to send for the doctor. Oh, he's a silly fool, my cousin. Did I tell you about my Auntie Elsie? Went on a nuts and bananas diet to lose weight.
No.
She ate nothing but nuts and bananas for weeks on end.
Did she lose weight?
No, but you should see her climb trees. I say, Mr. Roy.
Yeah?
Hasn't that boy got a long nose?
Don't be rude.
Oh, I bet he gets in a bit of a stew.
Read your book.
It's a nice waiting room, isn't it?
Very nice.
Mm. Our neighbour, Mrs. Brown, comes here 3 times a week, you know, to see the doctor.
Well, she's not here this morning, is she?
No, she couldn't come today. She's not well. My Uncle Fred was under doctor's scheme for a while.
Really?
Yes, but the doctor soon had him back on his feet. His bill was so high, he had to sell his car.
He
sell his car! Well, I'm sorry, everybody. Very sorry.
He should have gone under the National Health.
Yeah.
You know, you can get anything done under the National Health now, even cosmetic surgery.
What's that?
Well, it's to improve your appearance.
Oh,
you know, like having your face lifted.
Oh, Mrs. Brown had that done several times. She had her face lifted so often, when she wants to drink a cup of tea, she has to take her hat off.
Don't tell fibs.
Did I tell you about my friend who had an eyebrow transplant?
An eyebrow transplant?
Yes, he lost his eyebrows. So they made new eyebrows for him out of some hairs from an Airedale's leg. Now, every time he passes a lamppost, he looks surprised. Yeah, morning, Vicar. I say, Mr. Roy.
What?
That man's got his hand up. Do you think he wants to go somewhere?
There's something wrong with his shoulder.
Oh, poor chap. Good morning. Hope your shoulder gets better. Pleasure. I hope your foot gets better soon. Good morning. Hope your head gets...
Don't say that. He's a Sikh gentleman.
Well, that's obvious, isn't it? He wouldn't be seeing the doctor if he wasn't sick, would he?
You know Dr. Scheme's away at the moment, don't you?
Yes, I heard he's gone on a sort of busman's holiday. Sleighing in Switzerland. Sleighing in Switzerland.
The one you'll be seeing is a lady doctor.
I'm not a lady. I'm a chap. And a chap ought to have a chap doctor.
I mean, the doctor is a lady and she'll be examining you.
What, all over?
Well, if it's necessary, yeah.
Hope she hasn't got long fingernails. Cool.
Next patient, please.
Is it us?
That'll be us, Ben.
Oh, marvellous. Right up.
Well, come on.
I'm coming, all right.
Morning, Doctor.
Oh, good morning, Doctor.
Good morning, Mr. Brush, isn't it?
Yes, that's right, Basil Brush.
Oh, well, I think you better come and sit up here on the desk.
Oh, I can't jump up there. I'm not a blooming frog, you know. I say, give us a hand, Mr. Roy.
Well, as you probably know, Dr. Scheme is away at the moment. I'm his locum. All right, Mr. Brush?
Yes, thank you. I say, Mr. Roy.
Yeah?
Is she a student?
No, she's a practicing doctor.
Oh, I don't want her to practice on me. What?
I'm Dr. Foster.
Oh, how is it in Gloucester?
Oh, raining as usual. Have you seen a doctor lately?
Well, I haven't had any need to, no.
What about the little wheeze you were talking about?
I beg your pardon?
That little wheezing noise in your chest.
Oh, yes, I had a slight trouble with my breathing.
Oh, I can give you something to stop that.
What, stop my breathing?
No, you're wheezing, you nuts.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
Well, Mr. Brush, I think I better examine you. Would you go over onto the couch behind the screen?
Oh, all right, just a minute.
You're Mr. Brush's friend, I take it.
Yeah, that's right, Doctor. Roy North. He gets a bit nervous if I don't come with him, you know.
And how's your health, Mr. North?
Ah, very good, thanks. Well, I sometimes have a bit of trouble with a little pain in the neck.
Oh, I wouldn't call in that. Mr. Brush seems a very nice little chap.
I heard that.
I'll go and help him take his clothes off.
Oh.
There we are now, Mr. Brush. Let's have this off.
Go, I say, steady on, madam.
Please?
Go. I hardly knew you. Go. Go, Mr. Roy. She has got long fingernails. Go. Go. Doctor, your hands are blooming cold. Oh. Ooh. Cheeky. Go.
There we are, Mr. Brush. brush. Just put the dressing gown on and then come back to the desk, would you?
All right, yep.
Well, there's nothing much wrong with your little friend, Mr. North, apart from that little wheeze.
There we are.
Right, now then, Mr. Brush, I must take down your particulars.
Hey, you've just taken them down.
About this little wheeze in your chest, have you consulted a doctor before me?
Only Mrs. Brown.
Oh, Mrs. Brown, is she a doctor?
No, our next-door neighbour.
Oh, Mr. Brush, haven't you any sense at all? Huh? Mr. North, how stupid can some people be? Your Mrs. Brown is obviously not medically qualified. What sort of stupid nonsense has she been telling you?
She told me to come and see you.
I will get you a bottle of Linctus, and with some deep breathing exercises, we'll soon clear that little wheeze.
Oh,
there you are. I told you, didn't I? Deep breathing helps kill germs.
Yeah, but how do you get your germs to breathe deeply? Who's a little bony face then? Who's a little nosy face? Cool, you want to put a bit of weight on? Oh, he's quite pale.
Hey, I wonder what's wrong with this fella then?
I don't know, he won't tell me.
Ah, oh, it's marvellous, Buzz. I must have over 200 bones in my body.
Oh, I've got thousands of bones in mine.
Thousands? Don't be daft.
I have. I had kippers for breakfast. He's a little cheeky face.
Hey, I reckon you've got the same sort of bones as I have. Let's feel your clavicle.
Get off.
Your clavicle's your shoulder bone. Now, you see this lot of bones running down here?
Oh, that's pretty.
Now, that's your spine. It's very important, is the spine.
I know. Your head sits on one end and you sit on the other. Oh, that's a good joke, isn't it? Laugh, you fool.
I'd like to be a doctor, Basil.
Oh, yes.
Do you know, I reckon I've got the old bedside manner.
Does your wife know?
Hey, I can hear my heart beating.
How surprising.
Let me listen to yours.
Yeah.
Hey, how about that? This hot music playing.
I know. I've got heartburn. How does that thing work?
Ah, well, it's a stethoscope, and it's got a little microphone on the end here, like this.
Are you receiving me?
Here's your Linctus, Mr. Brush. Oh. Now, I want you to take one teaspoonful three times a day.
Oh, right here.
And don't forget to keep to the doctor's instructions. You didn't last time when he told you to drink a glass of orange juice after a hot bath.
Well, it wasn't my fault. After I drank the hot bath, I didn't fancy the orange juice. I drank so much water, my stomach was going in and out with the tide.
And to prevent any further infection, I want you to take a pill.
What, now?
Well, you don't have any trouble swallowing pills, do you?
No, Doctor. I heard the promise the government's made last week. If I can swallow that, I can swallow anything.
Right, now, here we are.
I'm not swallowing that! I'm not a blooming horse, you know.
Come on, Basil, a glass of water will help it down.
Oh,
come
all right.
On, put your head back now. Open wide.
It's an iron pill.
Come on, Mr. Brush, open up. There, now, drop a glass, Mr. North. Now swallow. Oh, all gone?
I can't.
Stop wasting the doctor's time. You all right, Basil? Has it gone?
Yes. Yes, it's gone, Mr. Roy. It's definitely gone. Oh, thank goodness for that. Oh, but Mr. Roy, yeah? On the way home, for goodness sake, don't point me at anyone.
An ounce of prevention is better than a cure.
When you're poorly, see the doctor right away. Don't just keep complaining.
Where your well is when it's raining. And don't forget to always eat an apple every day.
Too many sweets can be bad for your teeth.
True.
Eat a proper diet and your troubles will be fewer.
A dose of Johnson's Jollop packs a therapeutic wallop.
An ounce of prevention is better than a cure.
It's time, once again, for another thrilling episode in our serial story, Bulldog Basil, Secret Serviceman.
Yes, gather round, one and all, young and old, big and small, friends, Romans and countrymen, lend us your luggles.
Be quiet.
Ooh, pardon me for pontificating.
You talk too much.
That's not my fault. It's hereditary. My father was an auctioneer and my mother was a woman.
Do you mind if I read this story?
Yes, go on. Enthrall me, enthrall me. Send the old shivers up me brush. Come on.
Right. Now, you remember last week,
Mr. I say, Mr. Roy.
What?
What's that?
Oh, I'm glad you asked me that, and I'm very proud of it.
Yeah?
It's a bonsai. Now, it cost me £45, and it's over 100 years old. Right. Now, you remember...
You've got a new one for that.
Now, you remember last week? Yes. Bulldog Basil had left the full-time Chinese eating house to rejoin his butler cum bodyguard, Sailor Harris.
Yes, yes.
In that narrow, foggy street in Limehouse.
Yes, 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 yes.
When he suffered another threat from that scourge of the English countryside.
Yes, 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 yes.
A menace that strikes without warning.
It's a trade union.
It's not a trade union. I'm talking about his arch-enemy, Chu Fan Mu, and his companions, the dreaded Ying Tong.
The Ying Tong? Not to mention the Yid Lai Poo.
Yid Lai Poo.
I said not to mention the Yid Lai Poo. You didn't want me to say that, did you?
No, I didn't.
Please don't interrupt. I didn't know I was going to say that.
Suddenly, there was a clatter of hooves along the narrow street.
Yes.
And a handsome cab drawn by a frantically galloping horse bore down on them from out of the fog.
Oh, what a bore.
Look, sir, shouted Sailor Harris. Avast behind.
Oh, that wasn't a very nice thing to say about his master.
What wasn't a nice thing to say?
That he had a vast, what you said. Our neighbour, Mrs. Brown, has got a very vast one. But I wouldn't mention it in public.
What are you giggling at?
Mrs. Brown's vast, you know. From the back, she looks like two little boys fighting under a blanket.
I'm not talking about a vast anything.
Oh.
A vast behind is a nautical expression meaning look out behind you, stop, heave to, hold fast, belt up. So please, avast and listen.
Ooh, take the pictures down. Mr. Roy's going up the wall. Come on.
Now, where was I?
I'd say about as far as the picture rail.
Grabbing Basil around the waist.
That wasn't my waist, that was my hooter.
Harris pulled him into the narrow doorway and the speeding horse and vehicle thundered past them and on into the night. As it passed, the driver yelled, Gailo!
Gailo?
Yeah, that's Chinese for white devil.
Oh, charming.
And Basil looked up to see a villainous oriental face snarling down at him. What are you looking at me like that for?
I wouldn't say you're oriental. Oh, I don't know that. Come on.
Harris, said Basil, that cab driver was Chinese.
Oh, in those days, you know, they didn't have cabs in China. People used to be pulled around in little two-wheeled carts called rickshaws.
I know.
Yes, and all the horses looked like men.
That cab came from the direction of Charlie Perkins' pub down on the wharf, sir, replied Harris.
Yeah.
Charlie might be able to give us some information.
Yes.
You're right, Basil agreed.
Yeah.
The public bar was crowded, and Basil and Harris had to push their way through the smoky atmosphere to the bar counter, where the landlord, Charlie Perkins, was busy dispensing big tankards of a popular drink.
Pokey Pola.
No, not Pokey Pola. Mulled porter, a spice concoction made of ale.
Oh, my friend lives there.
Where, Limehouse?
No, made of ale. It's quite nice, please. Only 20 minutes from Marble Arch, by phone.
Mr. Perkins, called Basil.
Yeah?
I'd like a word with you when you're free. Perkins turned and said...
I'm free.
Perkins...
That's a good show, that, isn't it? I like that show. It's a good show.
Perkins turned and said, half a tick, Governor. And wiping his hands on his beer-stained apron, moved along the bar towards them. Evening, Gov. What you having?
A pokey polo in a dirty glass.
I don't want any refreshment, said Basil.
I do. My stomach thinks my mouth has gone on strike.
We should be so lucky. I require some information.
You didn't mean that, did you? You wouldn't say a thing like that to Basil.
No,
would you?
I wouldn't.
You're not being unkind to Basil. Don't be unkind to Basil.
Be quiet!
I didn't spit.
You did. When did a ship from Hong Kong berth here, and what was her cargo? About 3 weeks ago, Governor, replied Perkins. Dozens of blinking great boxes guarded by hundreds of Chinese coolies.
Good acting. Very good acting. Good actor. Good actor.
Unloaded it themselves. Wouldn't let our lads touch them. They had the lot out of the docks in an hour, smooth as you like, without an itch. What's the matter?
I wish I was. Cool.
What?
I've got a nasty itch right in the middle of my back.
Yeah?
Would you scratch it for me?
Mm,
oh, there we are.
Right,
oh, no. Down a bit.
Yeah?
Up a bit.
Right.
Left hand down. That's it. That's it. Oh, I like it. Oh, it's lovely.
Well, I mean, I can't spend all this time. I've got a story to read.
Oh, that's lovely. It feels nice, that.
Now, look, stop interrupting. It's very irritating.
Yeah, well, I've got a new woolly vest on, you know.
So that's it, Harris, said Basil. That villain Chu Fan Mu has the parts for his infernal disintegrating machine. We must get home at once and prepare to go to Milcombe House.
Yeah.
They made their way into Cable Street, where Basil hailed a passing hansom cab. Hey, hansom!
Yes, Judgy Face?
Fuck you!
God, watch it.
And mind my bonsai.
I didn't touch your bonzo.
It's a bonsai. I've got a new hobby, horticulture.
Oh, Mrs. Lighthouse won't like that.
Won't like what?
You indulging in naughty culture.
Not naughty culture, horticulture. I'm studying the Chinese art, the oriental art of growing miniature trees.
Oh, I see. Oh, look, his little ticker. Stay, stay, boy, stay. You only have to mention trees and he's in like a shot. Aren't you, ticker? Beg your pardon? Oh, all right, I'll ask him. Shut your little bones, you. That's a good doggy. Ticker says he wants to go walkies.
Well, he can't.
Stay.
You can't take him for walkies till after the show. He'll have to wait.
Oh, Mr. Roy said I can't take you walkies now. We'll have to wait until it's convenient. Huh? Oh, Ticker says he hasn't had walkies since lunchtime and it's urgent.
Well, I'm sorry, Basil, I can't help that. I've got this story to read and you've got to sing the song at the end. Tell him to hang on.
All right. Quiet, Ticker, quiet. Mr. Roy says, can you hang on for a bit? Well, try and think about something else. It might go away. Hurry up, Mr. Roy. Come on, hurry up.
All right, I'll read it as quick as I can. Now, you stay there, Ticker.
Yes, be a patient little doggy. Sing a little song or something to yourself. Carry on, Mr. Roy. Come on.
The hansom cab soon had them back at Basil's house in Burlington Gardens. And as Basil went up the steps, the front door opened. And there stood his friend, Lord Nerney. Thank goodness you're back, said Lord Nerney. Something terrible has happened.
You're dead right. Something terrible has happened. Oh, Ticker. You naughty boy! You're not supposed to go walkies on Mr. Roy's naughty culture! Look what you've done! Look! Oh! You've sabotaged Mr. Roy's bonzo! I'm sorry, Mr. Roy.
You should have stopped him, Basil!
How could I stop him? I can teach him the script, but I can't stop him ad-libbing. Aren't you going to finish the story?
No, it's too late.
Huh? That's what Ticker said.
Listen next week to another interrupted episode of Bulldog Basil's Secret Service.
You've got me in trouble again.
Basil was an agent in the service of the Queen.
Naughty little Ticker interrupted his routine.
Whenever danger threatened, he was always on the scene.
Villains used to tremble when they heard his name.
England was in peril and he knew what he should do.
Ticker ought to help him against that too fancy old move.
His motto was, defend the flag.
The old red, white and blue.
Hooray! Stand up for England, home and duty.
He was a brave man.
Bulldog Basil,
a secret service man. In India, in Africa, in China and Japan. They knew his reputation, he was a super spy. And the enemies of England heard his battle cry. Bye, Joe!